Thank you, David, and good morning, everybody. So today we'll be discussing a well-known construct called the Skyline, and we'll do it in the context of uncertain tasks. So let me start with a quick review of the Skyline. Skyline is a computational geometry that has maximal points. So given a set of points in the plane, for example, we say that the point O sub I dominates the point O sub j in O sub j lies in the southwest quadrant of O sub I. And the skyline is simply the set of all non-dominated points. So in this picture here, the skyline consists of the points that form that staircase contour. And it is unique, and it is well known that can be computed efficiently in all dimensions. And the skyline has many applications, particularly in multi-objective optimization and database query. For example, if you think of each point as representing, let's say, a hotel with some attributes, then a user might be interested in knowing what are the most interesting hotels to explore further. And the ones that are below the skyline are not of interest, but they're dominated by the points on the skyline. Okay, so this is a classical well-studied problem, and what we want to do is look at this in a slightly different setting. So in our setting, the points are given with known locations, and each point O sub I has associated with it some independent probability, P sub I, and we call this the existence probability. Now, as soon as you do this, problem becomes quite challenging because now there can be exponentially many skylines possible. And each skyline is now associated with some overall existence problem. Let me give you an example to illustrate this more. So here we have a set of points with their existence probabilities indicated by the scale numbers. Let's consider just the three red points shown here. With respect to the red set, these three red points form a skyline. And the question is, under what circumstances would these red points form a skyline of the entire set? So, clearly, for the red points to form a skyline of the entire set, they must be present to begin with. And the blue points, which are the ones above the skyline, in other words, the ones that are not dominated by any of the red points, should not be present, because if any of them is present, then the red points will not find the skyline. And notice that here the green points are irrelevant. Whether they are present or not doesn't affect the skyline good of the red points. So we can now define the probability of the red skyline as simply the product of the existence probabilities of the red points, the 0.6 times 0.5 times 0.4. And the non-existence probabilities of the blue point, so 1 minus the corresponding existence probability. And our goal here is to compute the skyline with the largest probability of existence, so we call this the most likely skyline. And again, this would be interesting because it's a skyline that the user is most likely to encounter in the expected sense. Okay, so what are our results? So we have two negative results and one positive result. So the negative results are that, as you might expect, for dimensions greater than or equal to 3, the problem is NP-hard. And in fact, it cannot even be well approximated in polynomial time, because P is equal to NP. On the positive side, for P equal to 2, we can compute the most likely skyline optimally in the big O and log of time with linear space.
Yes. So what do you mean by well approximated?
I will get to that in a minute, but basically, it cannot even be approximated to within a constant factor, and in fact, even stronger result will be shown with other machines later. Okay, so let's begin with the first problem, the NP hardness result. So, we are going to do a reduction from a known NP complete problem called the minimum epsilon ADR problem in R3. Here ADR stands for approximately dominating representatives, and I agree with that. So we just call it ADR. And the instance here consists of a non-stochastic point set S and a positive real number epsilon. Now, let's just look at the two red points, the this figure. These two points by themselves are not a skyline for the entire set, right? For example, the point A does not dominate the point B. However, if we were to, remember we have a real number epsilon here, so if we were to multiply the coordinates of each of these red points by 1 plus epsilon, so in other words, boost them by 1 plus epsilon in every dimension, then we get these purple points. So A becomes A hat, which is 1 plus epsilon times the coordinates of A and so on. And now you will see that the purple points actually dominate the entire set. So in other words, here we call this, the three images of the purple points, namely the two red points, A and E, as an epsilon ADR. And the motivation for this is that sometimes even the skyline might be too large for us to work with, and we may be happy to consider a slightly boosted, a slightly small, much smaller set of points that can boost it by a small amount, serve to dominate the entire set. So the goal here would be, can we find an epsilon ADR of small, of minimum cardinality? So this problem is NP hard. This is a result that was established back in 2001 by Christos Papadimitriou and analysis of mathematics. So we're going to use this for our proof of the most likely skyline problem. So how do we generate an instance of our problem? So we start with any epsilon ADR instance, the set of points in R3. By the way, all these figures are drawn in R2 just for the sake of convenience, but everything we're talking about is in R3. Then what we're going to do is we're going to try to generate the instance for the MLS problem. So we start by computing the conventional skyline, sky S, which is the points shown in red for the given set of points. And then we boost each of the points in the skyline by epsilon to get a set of purple points S n. Notice that the two black points that have been grayed out are no longer of interest to us. And then we need to assign, we want a stochastic data set, so we need to assign some probabilities. So we assign existence probabilities to the purple and the red points. Purple points get a probability of alpha, the red points get a probability of beta. And for technical reasons, as we'll see later, alpha and beta must satisfy those inequalities there. So for example, 0.4 for alpha and 0.6 for beta for here. You know, what is our instance for the MLS problem? It's basically the union of the set of red and purple points, so S bar, with the probabilities that we assign. Right. Now our goal is to show that if we have this instance, we can actually solve the problem. So a couple of observations that will help us. First observation is that the most likely skyline of this set is always a subset of just the purple points with all the red points below. So in other words, we cannot have a situation where we have, for example, this red point present along with this purple point and so on. And the reason for that is the following. If the most likely skyline contains a red point, we simply replace that with a purple point that dominates. So if you were to do that, let's ask ourselves, how does the probability of the skyline change? So after the replacement, the new skyline will have a probability that's related to the old skyline in the following way. Remember that in the old skyline, we removed a red point which had a probability of existence probability of beta. So we need to divide the probability of the old skyline by beta. And we've introduced a purple point which was previously not present. So it was contributing 1 minus alpha to the probability of the old skyline. So we need to divide by 1 minus alpha. And since now it is present, we need to multiply by alpha. So we basically get this multiplication factor alpha over 1 minus alpha times beta. And if you remember the inequalities that I showed you earlier for alpha and beta, turns out since we have designed this so that beta times 1 minus alpha is less than alpha, it follows that the probability of the new skyline is greater than probability of old skyline. So this means that we can continue to, anytime you have a red point, you can just replace it with a purple point and keep increasing the probability. Therefore, the most likely skyline is the second observation is that the most likely skyline has the smallest number of purple points among all such purple skylines below. And the reason for that, again, is based on all the inequalities we had earlier. So let me denote the size of the most likely skyline, the number of points, by n. And let capital K, or just K, be the total number of purple points. Then we know that the purple points are mutually non-dominating. again because they boosted versions of the Skyline vectors. Therefore, the probability of the most likely Skyline will essentially, since there are m points that lie on the Skyline, it will be alpha to the power n. And there are k minus m points that do not lie on the Skyline. So it will be 1 minus alpha times to the power k minus m. And you can rewrite that in an equivalent form. And now you'll notice that this term is fixed for a given instant. The domain was alpha and capital K fixed for a given instant. If you look at this term here, since alpha is assumed to be less than a half, alpha 1 minus alpha is less than 1, so that term is less than 1. And therefore, what it means is that if the probability of the most likely Skyline is maximum, then M must be good. So, this observation directly gives us the conclusion that if I have the most likely Skyline, I simply look at the three images of the points on the most likely Skyline, and that should yield an epsilon KDR or given set. So this essentially concludes that the most likely Skyline problem must be R. Any questions? All right, so let's move on to the next result, and this will answer your question partially. So the inapproximability of the most likely Skyline problem in R3. So let A be a polynomial time, what I call a C approximation algorithm, meaning that when you run it for the most likely Skyline, it becomes the probability of the Skyline that it computes divided by the probability of the most likely Skyline is larger than C, where C is some real number between 0 and 1. So the claim is the following. If C is greater than a half, then A does not exist unless B is equal to P. And more specifically, what we will prove upon the next couple of slides is that A does not exist if C is equal to alpha divided by 1 minus alpha. And if you recall, alpha was chosen to be greater than 1/3, that implies that C. And the proof basically goes by contradiction. Let's assume that A exists. So I'm going to run A on the set of purple and red points that we had earlier. And that gives us a most likely Skyline, let's call it Sky tilde. Now, the question is, what is the probability of Sky tilde? We know that because A is a C approximation algorithm and C is alpha or 1 minus alpha, we know that the probability of Sky tilde is alpha of 1 minus alpha times the probability of the most likely Skyline, and which you can rewrite in an equivalent form as alpha to the power m plus 1 to 1 minus alpha to the power k. Because the term here, alpha to the m, 1 minus alpha to the k minus 1, is the probability of the most likely Skyline. Okay, so, and we can also assume without loss of generality that this computed Skyline, that this algorithm A, has only purple points, because as before, we can simply do a replacement of red points and only increase the probability of the computer stuff. So you can assume that Sky tilde consists only of purple points. So now to clinch the proof, basically we want to ask ourselves how many points are there in Sky tilde. So observe that if a Skyline, any Skyline, has m plus 1 purple points on it, then that has a probability exactly alpha to the m plus 1, because there are m plus 1 points on the Skyline, and times 1 minus alpha to the k minus m plus 1, because the remaining points are not on the Skyline. So each time I add a new purple point to that Skyline, the probability will get multiplied by alpha or 1 minus alpha, because I'm removing a point that was, I'm adding a point that was previously assumed to be not in the Skyline, so I divide by 1 minus alpha, and since I'm adding it, I multiply by alpha. That quantity is less than 1, which means that as we add more and more points, the probability goes down. So, therefore, since the probability of the Sky tilde is known to be strictly greater than alpha to the m plus 1 times 1 minus alpha to the k minus m plus 1, that implies that the Sky tilde must contain fewer than m plus 1 points, and therefore it must contain m points. Not to take fewer than 10 points, but then the probability will be greater than 1,000 Skyline. And therefore, this implies that you can compute the minimum epsilon ADR of the set S by simply using the points in Sky tilde and the ages. So, yeah. So, okay, let's do regular. Okay, So then there is a stronger approximability result, which basically says that you cannot even approximate to this factor. And I will skip this because that will take too much time with the details. Let me move on to the positive result, right? Which basically says that we can compute the most likely skyline polynomial in the actual optimal thing about n. So let's sort the, this is in the plane, right? Let's sort all the points as by decreasing x coordinates as O1, O2, O3, etc. And let me define one term, which is psi sub I. Psi sub I is simply the most likely skyline of the first I points with the constraint that it terminates at the I point. So the one that is shown in red here would be sky of I. Now the probability of that skyline, I, would be given by this expression here, where Q sub k is just 1 minus P sub k. Now, we can further partition the blue points into light blue points and cyan points the following way. So what I've done here is I've taken the point O sub j that precedes O sub I of the skyline and drawn a rectangle with as shown here. And the cyan points are the points that lie in the rectangle. The light blue points are the blue points that are outside the rectangle. Now you can rewrite the probability expression by pulling out P sub I and then writing the remaining part of the product of P sub k here. And then I can again rewrite the product of the dark blue P sub k as a product of the two different shades of blue. Notice that for a given ij, this the cyan term, product of qk, is fixed. And this point here is maximized when the probability is actually equal to the skyline, the sky of j, in other words, the most likely skyline that O1 through OJ that terminates. So now you can see that this has a flavor of dynamic programming, and in fact, we can simply do a right to left sweep and solve this problem using that dynamic programming relationship that is implicit in this equation here. A little more detail that will kind of set up the more efficient algorithm for us. So let's assume that when the sweep is at the point O sub I, right, we can rewrite the probability expression for sky I as pi. And then I just call the cyan probabilities r value of oj. Since it's at oi, I don't have to include oi here. It's r value, r stands for the mnemonic for rectangle. Probability value of the most likely skyline. So p value, p is the mnemonic for probability. And the product of these two is called the score of oj, which I have known as the s value. So we can write the probability of sky I in this form. And the algorithm now is very straightforward, the n squared algorithm. Basically, what you do is you find, when you're at OI, you find the point OJ that is to your southeast, in the southeast quadrant, which has the maximum S value, right? The maximum S value here. Compute the p value of OI by multiplying that by P sub I. And then, crucially, once the sweep line moves to the left of O sub I, we need to multiply the R value of every OJ in the southeast quadrant of O sub I by Q sub I. Right? And that's the important step. And what you can see that if you implement this naively, this will run in of n squared time. So at this point, my time is up. Do you want me to stop or should I
start? You have to stop.
Okay. The next stop is on?
Yeah. So the 20 minutes are over for this talk. Is there anybody here for the next talk? I don't see anybody. So, you can give me some more time.
I see 5 minutes left.
Because there is no speaker for the next talk. So if everybody agrees, we can let the shooting show.
Okay,
5 minutes?
Okay, thank you. All right, so we have a naive algorithm in terms of quadratic time. The question is, how do we improve this? And we do this by introducing a new data structure that will allow us to essentially implement this step. So, here is the data structure. It's a D, right? And it's going to have three operations that will be performed when the point, when the sweep is at O sub I. First one is find the maximum S value when the sweep is at O sub I. In other words, it returns the maximum S value among all the points whose Y coordinates are below the Y coordinate of O sub I. That's not quite what I said. I said I want the southeast quadrant. But I can't say it's not everything below this. Fortunately, that's not an issue for us because if we do proper initialization, such that the points that are to the left of O sub I are given zero S value in the given structure, then even if we multiply them by, even if we operate on them, it won't matter because they have zero S value. So that's the reason the data structure can afford to be non-dimensional, and we can afford to query with this one-dimensional zero like and then we have an operation which sets the p-value of the point O sub I to be equal to P sub I times the maximum S value computer in the previous step. And then the gauge multiply operation, which is multiply all the points, R values of all the points to the southeast of O sub I from P sub I. And it turns out that we can implement these in operations in log n time per operation. These are worst case times, not advertised. So the runtime is big O of n log n. And I'll just give you a high level view of this. There are a lot of subtleties in the data structure, but the key idea is that do range multiply, we cannot afford to multiply every point in the range by Q sub I. That's obviously too expensive. So what we do is we group the points in the range into a small number of groups and apply the multiplication to each group. And then we propagate those values into the groups as needed in a lazy fashion. So we don't do it all at once. So this slide should convey the gist of the idea. So the next slide. So the data structure is a binary search tree where the points are stored by increasing y and leaves. And as I said, so if you look at the previous slide, this is my point with y coordinate yi, then I search down the tree for y sub I. I find it here, and immediately I get a grouping of the points into canonical subsets. So log n of these, we go log n. And then I have a field called prod at each node which accumulates the multipliers from current previous operations. And the invariant is that the R value of any leaf is simply the product of the prod values along the group to leaf path. So let's say that as we search down, we are at this node here, and we have a certain prod value that we accumulated from previous operations. I propagate those values to the two children. So I replace prod, the blue prod by the blue prod times the red prod, green prod by green prod times the red prod. And I replace this by 1 because this is now stuff. And then finally, I also the whole purpose of this operation is to assign multiply the values of these nodes by Q sub I. So we can do that by essentially replacing this at the canonical node only by prod times Q sub I. So essentially, we update the path by walking down, and at the canonical nodes, we update the prod times Q sub I. So this is a lazy estimate. And there are a couple more slides, I won't get into the details, but basically we have a couple of extra things and the p values, and then find the maximum best value to dollar of the point. Okay, so to conclude, we introduced this Skyline problem for stochastic results. As far as future work goes, I think there are a couple of directions that one can go. For example, playing one can look at a query version where the user is not interested in the entire data set but interested in a small range, query range, and you want to do the most likely slider inside the range. The other possibility is to look at this problem in what's called a multi-point model where point is not present in just one location but present in discrete different locations, each having a certain probability of occurrence, and you want to compute the most likely slider. So you have how to define that problem as a little. David, thank you for the expression. Thank you. And we're going to be
done. We found the speaker for the next one. Oh, so there's no time for questions. You're at 11:10?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. To clarify, the speaker for 11:10 is here. The speaker for 10:15 is not here. There's again, time for some questions. I don't see any. So let's thank Steve.
Thank you.